name is Sister Janice Fulmer, and I am a sister of the Holy Family of Nazareth. It is my privilege to share with you today very briefly about Nazareth spirituality. This spirituality is central to our congregation, to our way of life. As employees and board members of our sponsored institutions, we invite you to incorporate some of the values of this spirituality into your own lives. I want to begin by speaking a little about the term spirituality itself. Some of you may be thinking, that's a term reserved for priests and nuns or the very holy, but not for me. But that isn't true. Each one of us has a spirituality, even if we don't identify it as such. So let's unpack that term. Simply stated, spirituality means the way in which a person meets God, relates to God in his or her everyday life. It may include practices such as prayer, reflection, attentiveness, quiet time, or even scripture reading. When a person seeks to know and love God better, he or she must actively engage in practices which will help him or her. Spirituality is the way you meet God and stay in touch with God. So you already have your own spirituality. When you look at the profession cross that each Sister of Nazareth wears, you find the words, Exsce Regnum Dei intra vos est, that is, behold, the kingdom of God is within you. These words very succinctly express the foundation for Nazareth spirituality. As you have already heard several times in the first series of this program on mission advancement, God dwells within each one of us. In order to meet God, to be in touch with God, all we have to do is take the time to recognize that God is within me in my deepest self. Our Blessed Foundress, Mary of Jesus the Good Shepherd, knew very well the presence of God within her. She was drawn to the Trinity, Father, Son, and Holy Spirit, and saw the Holy Family, Jesus, Mary, and Joseph, as the reflection of the Trinity on earth. In particular, she meditated on the life of the Holy Family of Nazareth and drew from these reflections certain core values which she strived to live in her daily life and which she asked the women who followed her to embrace as well. As employees and board members of institutions and ministries sponsored by the Sisters of the Holy Family of Nazareth, you have most likely watched the first series of the Mission Advancement videos. So you know that faithful listening, loving relationships, and recognizing God in the everyday are the values that our Foundress believed were essential for those who wished to follow the example of the Holy Family at Nazareth. Blessed Mary of Jesus the Good Shepherd believed that if her sisters lived these values and related to each other as family members, that they would understand better how to be of service to families and perhaps be an example to them of how to deal with the difficulties of family living. If she were here today, I think she would say to you, strive to follow the example of the Holy Family of Nazareth within your own family and within the larger family of the children of God. Jesus, Mary, and Joseph lived a very ordinary life in Nazareth. They lived as a family, sharing joys and sorrows, working together, celebrating together as families do. I doubt that their neighbors saw anything extraordinary about them. For example, when Jesus was engaged in his ministry as an adult, the people of Nazareth scoffed and said, "Isn't he the carpenter's son?" They wondered how he got to know so much and how he could preach to them. However, while the Holy Family appeared very ordinary, they lived in an extraordinary way. We know from scriptures that all three of these family members listened faithfully to God. They chose to do God's will despite what seemed to be impossible things that God asked of them. They heard God's message and followed it even amidst great difficulty. They listened to holy messengers from God, but surely on a day-to-day basis, they listened respectfully to each other. We don't hear in the scriptures much about how they listened to each other, but we know, for example, that when Jesus was left behind in the temple and his parents came looking for him, that he listened to them. He returned with them to Nazareth, even though it may have seemed to him that he was called to do something else. Or we know that at the wedding feast at Cana, Mary pointed out to Jesus that they ran out of wine, and Jesus responded, he listened. We learn faithful listening in the family. As part of our daily lives, we too are called to be faithful listeners. In our families, in our ministries, in our prayer, we discover what God asks of us by listening faithfully to those around us, to the situation at hand, and to that inner voice that guides us. We actually learned to be faithful listeners in our families. When we were sick, our parents knew it without us saying anything. They were attentive to us and listened, if you will, to the signs that showed them something wasn't right. We learned from our parents by watching how they listened to each other as they resolved family problems. I don't know about your family, but in mine, there were always seemed to be aunts and uncles and cousins around. My mom and dad would sit for hours and listen to their troubles and offer them comfort, understanding, and acceptance. This faithful listening must be cultivated in our daily lives so that we become more and more aware of what God desires for us and what God asks of us. When we read the scriptures and meditate on the Holy Family, it is easy to see that the love of God reigned in that family. First and foremost, Joseph, Mary, and Jesus were faithful Jews. They followed the customs of their faith to give honor and glory to God. As an infant, Jesus was presented in the temple, and Mary and Joseph offered a sacrifice of thanksgiving, as was customary. And later we know that he accompanied his family and kinsmen on the pilgrimage to Jerusalem, where they could worship in the temple. And although the scriptures are silent for the most part about the interactions of this family, we can read between the lines. Joseph, for example, must have loved Mary very much because he loathed to make her pregnancy known when he found her with child before they lived together. Jesus expressed his love for Mary when at Cana she simply said to him, "They have no wine." Jesus worked this miracle in response to her comment. Surely this speaks of his love and respect for Mary. Further, we might ask, how did Jesus become so loving and caring to those who came to him for healing or to hear his message? Did he not learn this from Mary and Joseph at Nazareth? Surely Mary and Joseph educated Jesus by their example of love and care in the home at Nazareth. From them, he experienced the reality of affection and the importance of love. You and I were taught how to love first and foremost by being loved. The message of the Synod on the New Evangelization from October of 2012 states, "Family life is the first place where the gospel meets the ordinariness of life and shows its ability to transform the basic conditions of existence towards the horizon of love." Pope Francis described the family as the primary cell of society where we can find the basic values of love, fraternity, and mutual respect. When I am loved by another, my mother, for example, she loves all of me, including the potential in me. Her love enables me to become more than I am today, the person who God is calling me to be. And when I love, I do the same for the other. I remember reading in my studies as a young sister a description of how loving someone changes our perspective. The author claimed that love was like putting on a pair of glasses that enabled you to see all of the goodness and potential in the one who is loved. This is what happens in the family when we are loved and when we love. We are almost pulled to become more, to be that person God intends us to be, and at the same time, We receive the tools to be lovers as well and help others to become the persons God wants them to be. The family is indeed the tabernacle of the person. The Holy Family did not have the knowledge that the scientific world presents to us today about the creation of the world and human life. They didn't hear that the Almighty created the universe from one big bang that gradually evolved into all that we see today and all that is to come. Yet, because of their deep faith and profound love of God, we can deduce that they experienced God in each other and all of creation. Joseph and Mary had to have profound faith in order to agree with God's plan for bringing his son into the world. This faith enabled them to see God everywhere in creation, in other people, in other living things, and even in the inanimate. The way that they cared for others and all of creation gives evidence that they found God everywhere in everything. We know that Joseph worked with his hands as a carpenter for the town of Nazareth. Certainly, he cared for the wood that he turned into tables, chairs, and other items for the home, as well as things needed for working in the fields or with the animals. Mary surely found God in the ordinary actions of cleaning the house, preparing kosher meals, washing the clothes, and doing all of those things any wife and mother would do to make a home for her family. Together, Joseph and Mary watched over Jesus and taught him about the sacredness of all of the things. In our families, we find God in the ordinary, simple, day-to-day experiences and in the miracle that each person is. Surely a mother sees the Creator in the faces of her children and experiences God's love through the love of her husband. A father experiences God's love when he sees his wife hovering over a sick child or caring for an elderly parent or in her loving touch as she caresses his face. Children learn from their parents how to discover God everywhere, in the beauty of a sunset, the hug of a friend, and the joy of learning something new. In the ordinary tasks of everyday life, we can experience the holy if we but open our minds and hearts. And it is within the safe and loving environment of the family that we take our first steps to open ourselves to God and to accept what comes in a spirit of faith. Now it may seem from what I have said that I'm talking about perfect or exceptional families, but I'm not. All of us come from imperfect families, imperfect lives. Even the Holy Family didn't have a perfect situation, and they were human after all. Mary was almost an unwed mother. Jesus was born in a manger while they were on a trip. Joseph and Mary had to flee into Egypt to save Jesus from being slaughtered as a child, or even the fact that Joseph and Mary lost Jesus in Jerusalem. All of these give us indications that life for the Holy Family was not always easy. As human beings, they experienced the same kind of difficulties that families of their times did and families do today. While Hugh and I come from ordinary families that sometimes struggle financially or have to deal with crises like a terrible illness or a family member's addiction, God is always there for us if we only have faith. Our families may not have been perfect, but they are the families that we have. They have helped us to become the persons that we are today with our own strengths and weaknesses. Our challenge is to create family wherever we are and to do the best that we can. We can learn to appreciate God's family everywhere, not only in church, but in our homes, in our workplaces and ministries, and even where we recreate. Each of us must commit ourselves to be faithful listeners who love God and others as we seek and find God in our ordinary, everyday lives. In this way, our spirituality will more and more become like that of Jesus Mary and Joseph at Nazareth.